Good afternoon. My name is John Rowan. I'm a partner here at the Cam Fitzgerald. I've been involved with Brexit since the very beginning. It's my great pleasure to welcome you here to our office and also to our last session this afternoon. This session will be a purely interactive session with our four panel members, and we'd like to try and finish around about the 4:30 mark as promised, and to involve you with as many Q&As as you might want at the end of the afternoon. So very briefly, just to introduce my panel. You know all of them, but very briefly just to remind you. Danny McCoy is the Chief Executive Officer of IBEC, post he assumed back in July 2009. Beside him is John McGrane, who is the Director General of the British Irish Chamber of Commerce, following a lengthy career in banking with the Royal Bank of Scotland and Ulster Bank Group. Neil McCarthy is the Managing Director of Cork Airport. And our final gentleman at the end of the panel is Jim McDonnelly, who is a partner in the Tax Services Group at PwC here in Dublin. I'm going to start, if I may, with a question to Danny. And it comes, Danny, in the context of figures from the Enterprise Ireland published last week, which said that growth in exports to the United Kingdom is down from 12% in 2015 to just 2% in 2016. To you, I understand, Danny, it's all about trade and investment, Brexit, and therefore, in your view, optimum strategy is to collaborate and compete with the United Kingdom. What does that actually mean?
Yeah, so maybe just making the state, and that's bringing the other state. Trade and investment are not the same thing in a small open economy like Ireland. What I mean here is that when you look at trade flows, there's a lot of prism put on the trade flows like a normal economy. Most of the trade from Ireland is a function of an investment decision. You know, the medtech doesn't grow on the ground in the west of Ireland. It was an initial investment decision by biopharma medtech companies to make this decision into Ireland. And at the moment, of those two very big sectors, about 46% or so of their exports go to EU26. So it's huge, but it's only half the story. So the other part is contestable in a hard Brexit with Britain being aggressive on proper taxation. Now, the separate side, there is trade related to the natural assets, the grass, the agriculture, the agri-food. And that requires a soft Brexit because we need to have access to the markets. And so it is difficult then in that context to have a singular optimal strategy. We need to both compete on the investment and collaborate on the trade. We need a soft Brexit on the trade. If it was purely investment, then a hard Brexit would actually suit Ireland. And so that's what I mean. We've got to find a way of blending those two.
And is that realistic? Because clearly we are going to be competing with Ireland.
I'm not sure it's realistic or not, but I certainly don't believe that. I'm not of the view that we are firmly with a consistent policy in the EU27. So that's politically the story. If you believe that is a business optimal strategy, then you're fooling yourselves. People are already making decisions about where to try to get over the problem on the collaborate trade position. They're already moving to the inside in the same customs union. If you believe that Britain is not going to be a leader on corporate taxation, then you're also looking at that in another world. Business knows we're in this dilemma. Ireland has to try to find some blended solution, and we have to be clever enough to be able to say what Britain needs to do. That deal fundamentally is our deal.
John, a blended solution to what Danny's just said there. So for Irish businesses, we do a lot of business with the UK, we want to increase that as a deal because it's a market and understand this. Is such a thing possible, a blended solution?
Oh, everything's possible. You know, this is a political outcome, but a civic or a business, certainly a business outcome. So everything's possible because it's political, and political steps that get taken, you know, roll forward into whatever happens next. We're in the business of trying to plant that. For business, large or small, business is pragmatic. It's apolitical. It doesn't have a point of view necessarily in these things. It just wants to get business done, and it will find a way to get things done. And it's going to have to find a way in circumstances where none of this makes any sense for UK business PLC at all. Mrs. May hasn't delivered for, you know, the key big heavyweights of financial services and life science, hasn't given them a deal actually thought they were going to get. And small enterprise, the backbone of both the UK economy and the Irish economy, has nothing in it from this process at all. It's completely exposed. But don't read across to say, so that means it's just going to sit there and say we'll take whatever comes. Business is pragmatic and practical. In huge numbers of cases on both islands, are already thinking about what happens next and are taking practical actions and lead from the ostensible challenge in significant measure that it talks about, but thinking about how do you turn that into opportunity. And that arises from a straight conventional business analysis of where's the winners and where's the losers, what is stopped and what is made possible by all of this. And macro factors like the tax rate, there's no doubt about that. Britain, Northern Ireland, doesn't have a lot of financial space wriggle room. Britain's £2 trillion of debt. British consumers are much of a net in consumer debt.
Just let me go back to the point just a little second, Joe. So business and trade is a political problem. Does that mean it's a model? Is there a responsibility on trade and on Irish business to do something to help? There's an overall view here. Brexit is bad for Ireland. Is there a responsibility on business to do something?
Of course. And in the UK, not least, and we had a bit of this here in the past ourselves, business stayed far too quiet, and it has gotten what it deserves for that in the UK. It's placed itself in a terrible predicament with massive uncertainty and the loss of significant markets. And our own diplomats, meanwhile, on this island, have done extraordinary work, in my opinion, to bring about a situation for this tiny little island beside a slightly larger island offshore the continent. Has been called out as having unique exposure and unique circumstances that deserve a unique hearing. Turning that into actionable steps can't be just sat on the shoulders of diplomats and officials, no matter how excellent they are. That's the call for business to come forward with a pragmatic thinking that says, well, how would you run open or softer borders? How would you run free movement? How would you run trade in the context of these two circles here? It's time for business to get together and look at how those solutions can be brought back to the negotiators in a negotiation ready condition to get to the next steps for what we've done so far.
To pick up John's thought there, Neil, it's up to business to come up with solutions and to bring them to politicians, to bring them to the negotiators. You're and Jacqueline earlier referred to the aviation business.
Yeah.
That's a huge business for Ireland, not just in people coming in and out on planes, but also leasing business in Ireland. Are there practical problems or practical solutions that arise from the problems that you foresee going forward?
Yeah, before we define solutions, we need to define the problems in terms of aviation. Michael O'Leary spoke out earlier this week, and when airports and airlines are violent in agreement, obviously we need to take notice. So we're absolutely aligned with Michael O'Leary in terms of what he said. What he said was some of the things that we most value, we take for granted. And so your ability to get a plane in Dublin Airport and fly to Pula in Croatia or fly to Timișoara in Romania is governed by what's called Open Skies. And everybody thinks they understand Open Skies. So Open Skies came from the 1980s. And a lot of people in this room remember in the 1980s, where you had state airlines were lost in 80. There was protection of national airlines. There was restrictions imposed on where you could fly to. And there was a lot of red tape. And anyone over a certain age will remember things like the Shannon stopover, where if you wanted to go to Chicago, you had to tip down the Shannon because the quota applied. The EU, and we don't hear the word visionary applied often, but the EU was visionary back in the 80s. It said, we can't have this international. We're going to have to think of Open Skies. And what it says is that there's going to be free market competition in aviation. There's going to be no protections. We're going to restrict state aid to where it's absolutely necessary. And that fair prices are determined by market forces. And that sounds like just common sense. And so that determines that an Irish airline like Ryanair can fly from Hamburg to Croatia without any red tape. And what we're saying is that Open Skies is an EU concept. And when Britain divorces the EU, it divorces, for example, Open Skies. And so whilst they want back into it, they will have to negotiate their way back into it. And it makes sense for everybody to let them back in. But as of the day that Britain leaves, they leave things like Open Skies. And so what he's saying is unless there's an alternative framework in place there to govern air travel, there will be shocks to the system. And so we're saying as an aviation industry, we're saying don't forget aviation. It is critical to tourism. That there's a lot of business people here, and today, and business thinks business is central to everything, but on the 33 million passengers who traveled through Republic of Ireland airports last year, 80% of those defined their reason as being leisure. And so business is only 20% of the volume of any flight. A bit more in Heathrow, it's a bit more in Amsterdam. But 80% of people using Irish airports are defining themselves as leisure. Leisure can be annual holiday, weekend break, visiting friends and family, going to a funeral, but it's leisure and so on. Britain is the biggest market for that leisure by volume. And so what I'm saying today is I'm saying watch aviation. It has a massive effect on travel and tourism. Travel and tourism employs 1 in 9 people in this economy. And if we don't put in place a decent framework, there's going to be a shock to that system. The CSO this morning published the figures and they showed that British market is already declining to Ireland. So to go back to your original question on solution, rather than waiting on this to happen, we should be marketing Ireland in the UK. So let's not just be victims of Brexit. We need to increase the budget of tourism Ireland. The Irish Tourism Industry Confederation said 12 million extras needed to market Ireland abroad. People endorse that. And we need to diversify to new markets, so the States, Ireland, and so on. But there's things we need to be doing now in terms of preparedness for Brexit, or there'll be a shock to the system when people don't get on Brexit.
There are opportunities over Ireland in relation to, we're already an enormous success in the aircraft leasing world.
Yes.
You would imagine that Brexit will only underline that advantage we have.
Yeah, one of the peculiarities of the freedom of movement within the EU is that an airline to operate from a point to point within the EU has to be EU-owned. So people don't realise that. And so there's peculiarities in opportunity and threat things like that. Despite perception, the majority of Ryanair shares are held by foreign entities. EasyJet is majority controlled in the UK. So some of these companies are going to have to put in place new structures in terms of how they're governed, how they're owned to continue to operate where they are. There's going to be potentially airlines that are looking to set up new offices, British-based airlines, and Ireland will be an attractive place for those. There's opportunity in aircraft leasing, but even at its simplest level, and just talking to the traveling public, it would appear that duty free is going to come back to the UK. So that's very small, important for airports, but because Brexit is a shock to the system. It's mostly negative, there's some positive. I mean, there are some positives.
Jim, can I put that to you? In your financial services practice, you do a lot of aircraft leasing, similar to aircraft vessels. Are you seeing opportunities in that? Are there opportunities in that field for Ireland's result?
I don't think I would attribute any specific opportunities around aircraft leasing to Brexit because, you know, remember Ireland has built its aircraft leasing industry up over the past 40 years. And the UK, I don't think we would have seen as a particular competitor, for example, in that sector. Our competitors tend to be further afield, the likes of Singapore, and we hear over the next month or so that Hong Kong is also trying to get in on the Aircraft Leasing Act as well. So having said that, you know, 40 years of experience, 40 years of the infrastructure that Ireland has in aircraft leasing, and by infrastructure, I mean not only the people, and there are a lot of people directly employed within the aircraft leasing sector, but all of the surrounding sort of ecostructure as well. You know, I suppose on the likes of ourselves, we provide services to the likes of the banks, we provide services to the sector, are well embedded here, and I don't see that there's any particular threat to that. The global opportunity for leasing is still growing, so we will take advantage of that.
But let's get into the general financial services sector. What are you seeing? What is your sense of how well positioned Ireland is in relation to markets and competitors for new business or relocation businesses?
I think from a tax point of view, we're well positioned. Certainly the easy answer is always to point to the corporate tax regime that we have, the 12.5% tax rate, which I noted from the Conservative Party manifesto last week, I think it was, that Theresa May was talking about reducing UK corporate tax rate to 17%, the lowest corporate tax rate in the developed world. But But the 12.5% rate is certainly really, really important. But the importance of that would differ from sector to sector within the financial services area. The very big players, the very big banks are probably more focused on regulatory requirements than tax rate. But other people, such as the broker-dealer sector, the tax rate, the corporate tax rate, will be important for them. But what's really important, I think, more important probably at the outset than the corporate tax rate, is the personal tax regime that we have. And that's because I think we're all becoming more and more convinced that what wins we will have, and we will have wins here, we are seeing some, there will be more, is going to be, those wins are going to be very people driven. The chatter for quite a number of months, certainly at the start of this year, was around what will the local regulator, to the extent that there is a local regulator, because the ECB really controls everything, but to what extent the local regulator will accept, as little as possible here compared to what other regulators are looking for. There was a bit of chatter around that, which really didn't make any of us feel that easy, talking about regulatory arbitrage. But what has happened in more recent times is the ECB has come out and has made very, very strong statements that there would be no race to the bottom as far as regulation and supervision is concerned, that they're not going to accept shell companies in any jurisdiction. There need to be people to manage risk, supervise the business, and all of that sort of stuff. And this is really good news for Ireland. It's a message that the central bank here has been giving out really from the outset. So we are going to win business, and it means people coming here. But to maximize the opportunity, we need to sell our personal tax rates better and have the right tax regime. John alluded to the fact that Ireland is under budgetary constraints still, and we're hearing more of that as the weeks go by. So there may not be a whole heap that government feels it can do on tax rate, although there have been positive noises made about that. But I think the messaging is important, because when you see comparatives of Ireland with its main competitors around Europe, and the main competitors really being Frankfurt, Paris, Luxembourg and Amsterdam. When you see those comparisons of personal tax rates, Ireland always comes in at the top. There's always this headline rate of 52% quoted, which is higher than anyone else's. But that's actually very misleading, because in the first instance, that's a headline tax rate. It's not an effective tax rate. And actually, the effective tax rate is probably more around the 40%, and that's an all-in rate. But also, when you take into account that the type of people who are coming in here will be able to avail of what's called the Special Assignment Relief Program, or SAR, which is a relief that will reduce their income tax from, say, that 40% down to something more than 36%, then we're in the ballpark with everyone else, and better in many instances.
Thanks, Jim. I'm going to turn the topic over to SMEs. John Bradley, and his papers referred to often today, but an interesting statement in his papers is, the dominance of FDI in Irish manufacturing and in sub-sectors of market services has created an industrial strategy divide that is unhealthy and not often found to the same extent in other developed countries. So he goes on to say that dealing with Brexit is a challenge, but it should provide an opportunity for completing the modernisation of our indigenous SME sector. Now, what's your thought in relation to that?
It's exactly what I said earlier on. There's a real distinction between the investment and the trade, because our SMEs, when they do trade internationally, are heavily dependent on Britain. Particularly when you go down to industries that are actually possibly unrelated to foreign direct investment. If you had a real analysis that looked at the spillover effects of the FDI model, you will find that a lot of the SMEs who are I think the diagnosis is not to say we've got to focus in on one or the other, because the post-OECD work, I think, has been an absolute game changer for Ireland, which is we're now seeing substance and tax strategy being aligned. And a lot of people are saying that those GDP numbers are not reflective of something. What they mean by that is not reflective of the experience of somebody on the street at that moment. But the economy grew not by 26% in 2015, it grew by 33% in money terms. That's what's driving the denominator on the debt to GDP ratio. But more crucially, it also generated a surprise $2.5 billion of profit taxation. In other words, the 12.5% effective rate was surprise $20 billion of profits in the Irish economy in 2015. And I haven't seen anybody try to take that money off the table and put it into infrastructure that's non-recurrent. The government's saying they won't react to it, but the problem is the private sector has already reacted to it. People are being competed out of the rents in this part of the city by that very same phenomenon. The rental market is a new rate of Avalon over the weekend at 70 euros per square foot. I can guarantee you that SME or even the large artists are not able to compete with those kind of rents and productivity that they have. So the phenomenon is here already, but we seem to have our head in the sand. And then some people are saying we should make a distinction between these two types of businesses. That's just crazy. You have an asset. Try to make sure that asset is actually embedded here and then gives rise to a solution that involves blending. We don't blend. But if we don't blend and we don't find a mechanism to blend, my view is we're in very serious trouble with the result of Brexit. We will splinter the Irish business model. Different sectors, completely different business models. And so if we have a one size fits all EU 27 approach to Brexit, Ireland will be spinning.
I think that John Bradley mentioned two positive the opportunity to complete the modernisation of the SME centre is upon us. Is that too optimistic? Too ambitious?
I was interested, just as I scanned through the IRA's latest strategy report, it's a fantastic piece of work. Like it does cause you to pause and say, can Secretary 2 offers almost a health and the profile of Irish SMEs? If I remember rightly here, being an SME in Ireland in 72 wasn't exactly a badge of honour. It was usually the job you got when you couldn't get a proper job and all of those types of things. And the work that people have done since then, over a lengthy period of time, off the back of how we availed of the EU membership model that drove our FDI model and many other things, and Enterprise Ireland, and Sierra Enterprise Ireland, the bolt on that our indigenous firms were given to the success of internationalism in the economy, that's left us now with actually a very rich diversity in the economy. 250,000 SMEs, probably 1 million people, make up well over 98% of the total business population. That's not to say it's in perfect order, but it's come a long way. And Irish firms, as a broad rule, are well able to punch on the marketplace that they have, whether it's at home or abroad. And there's much more to be done. And Danny, more than many, talks about the constant need for competitiveness, and we have to keep that in focus, and whether that's about personal tax rates or the cost of infrastructure, etc., etc. But what I'm interested in is where does this take us next? This is our Whitaker moment for the next 60 years. We can either regard the Brexit piece as just the latest thing to come along, but it's clearly much bigger than that. But the context in which we address it needs to be thought of as a much longer term opportunity for this economy to go to the next phase, not to complete something, but to naturally go forward from whence we come. We think back to Whitaker and the mass now with great pride and admiration for people who had significantly less certainty than we have now and almost no resources compared to the huge resources that we have. We should be thinking about this as the first step in saying, what do you want your kids to say in 60 years' time, or grandchildren say in 60 years' time, about the choices that we have the privilege of making now, taking things in the round and saying, this is a game change. How we act and how we respond to it will define outcomes for two generations to come.
Ian, you worked before the aviation industry in the retail sector, so you probably have a very good sense of smaller SMEs and their, not just their fears, but the opportunities to compete something.
I did, and taking it back to our particular point in terms of tourism is the ultimate SME. If you go outside the main cities, Dublin, Cork, and Galway and so on, but even small towns going are hotels and restaurants, small businesses as well. The trickle down economics that is going to those places. And so our call out in terms of Brexit is, let's remember 42% of our visitors still come from the UK. It's trickling to all parts of our economy. If it catches a cold, our economy will catch a cold. If we catch a cold in parts, but it'll be gone. And so we're saying just need to mind that and protect it hugely and really watch it.
As somebody who talked earlier about personal taxation, SMEs don't often do sexy international aircraft leasing transactions, but they provide the backbone to the Irish economy, and will determine whether we come out of Brexit in a successful way.
Yes, certainly from that point of view, I think there's a huge challenge for our SME sector. Again, looking at what's been touched on in the previous panel, looking at the likes of the agri-food sector that makes up so much of our SME business here, the challenge that sector faces in terms of its exports to the UK, which we do so much of, where for the first time in 40 odd years, there are going to be customs barriers of some description. And whether those customs barriers result in tariffs, actual tariffs, which you know we probably have to plan for that. But even without tariffs, the non-tariff barriers that will be there will be huge for that sector to cope with. So just somebody exporting their product from here to the UK, having to go through all of the paperwork, which cannot be underestimated, and the cost of doing that paperwork. We had a client, actually, a discussion with a client who would be a medium-sized food processor, shipping about 50-odd containers of product to the UK on a weekly basis. And the estimate, and this is not an estimate of tariffs, this is the estimate of just additional cost from filling in paper, getting agents, customs agents to do it and all the rest of it. The additional annual cost for that business was somewhere in the region of 250,000 to 300,000 euro a year. And that's on a business that's already operating on pretty wafer thin margins. So that alone is huge. And the problem that we do face is that we actually don't have enough customs related expertise in this country to help SMEs and others with that sort of challenge. But we need more.
Just pick up on that. I can sense exactly almost a sense of frustration slash impatience of your part of not taking the point of that trade and investment, not taking this blended control. Enterprise Ireland announced just 10 days or so ago a new strategy which is facilitate grant aid to develop national training to arrange additional training visits. Is that beginning to be enough?
Well, look, it's the right thing to say. You know, the idea of 500 million consumers revealed preference. We've had 500 million consumers available for quite some time. The revealed preference is to trade with the 65 or so. That's going to take a long time to change attitudes, supply chains, and so on. The one thing when I said about the one size fits all, just maybe to confirm what I mean by that, is if you do the thought experiment that this was a reunified island, so you actually had a nice, neat island member state, there isn't a snowball chance in hell that you would have a common travel area play right now. Right? Think about that. And then in that regard, you know, when you move on from that, how are we going to ensure that given where we find ourselves in the business community, the East-West is the dominant business relationship. And so we wouldn't be actually diplomatically looking for a North-South solution. We'd be crying for a force majeure problem for a small island off a G7 country having made this very dramatic decision. And therefore, we'd be looking for relief from rules around state aid, fiscal, and the push for a common consolidated corporation tax base, which is back on the agenda. And the narrative back into our EU 27 partners is, if Ireland loses the investment that is in the EU at the
moment that doesn't need the EU26, and there's quite a significant amount of that in Ireland, the next port of call would be to go to Britain, and therefore, by definition, out of the EU. Ireland is not just looking for this investment for Ireland, it is actually where the investment comes into the EU. Anybody who thinks that the decision to come to Ireland is a pure EU26 access play is very much mistaken when you look at the facts.
Also, about state aid, because Danny and I have, since the start of the term this year, been trying to stimulate government into invoking, looking for state aid holiday. Certain sectors, maybe only a food and agri issue, but I don't think you necessarily want to deal with that sort of message.
State aid is sort of topic of the month, obviously, given the recent experience with Apple here, for example, but also in other countries as well, Amazon, Starbucks, and so forth. I honestly don't know what the chance of success is with regard to a state aid holiday. I think that to some extent, that might depend on what the UK does. The UK has said, well, we'll be free of the shackles of the EU and the constraints of the EU as far as state aid is concerned. But having said that, the UK will, even in a worst case scenario, will be subject to WTO rules, and even built in within those rules, there are certain state aid type things. So there might still be some constraint, not nearly as much as would be applied by EU. So having some sort of holiday would be great, but I just don't know how that's going to pan out.
It's not even a holiday we're looking for, it's to use our own money. It's actually more about the fiscal rules.
I'm not sure the law is necessarily really on that.
I think it's absolutely getting to the core of what we're talking about. If we aren't aware of the fact that this is a force majeure for our everybody in this room has said that Brexit would be negative, it's a question of agreeing to it. And we want to stay in the EU27. But the question now is, what is facilitated to allow us as a society, we don't face the same threats coming forward?
What will the threats be? That sounds like a threat to the EU26.
We can't threaten the EU. We're too small. But if we work on the basis that we are a very important part of the EU27, which I hear a lot of people saying that, you know, that we really are valued. Well, we're putting up our hand to say this is a force majeure, and let's not get distracted on the north-south piece. It's the east-west dimension that's the most dominant problem for Irish business. The north-south isn't the issue for business.
Well, so far as I'm aware, the Irish government, and we've been told by the EU26 as well, is we will be heard and heard most sympathetically, but we will be heard in accordance with existing EU laws. Therefore, we're going to have to try to seek holidays or indulgences or support or whatever through the use of existing EU laws. And there's two possible ways. One is to say we invoke this serious disturbance to the Irish economy. The danger is Europe turns around and say, why don't you start collecting some water taxes? Why don't you start raising your later immigration taxes? So we have to be a little bit careful about how we bail.
We're before that, obviously.
Neil, your thoughts in relation to this?
You mentioned the common travel area, and I think that deserves a little bit of airtime. Everyone preaches that we want to retain the common travel area, but we haven't really debated what that means or what the risks are to that. So in broad English, the common travel area, when you drive to Europe, you're availing of the common travel area for no passport control. When you fly to a UK airport, you run a channel that says UK Channel Islands domestic traffic. So you go to a different channel than French people. And so your passport is not checked on entry to the UK except for terrorism control purposes. So all the other countries in the EU, 22 of the rest of the countries in the EU, have what's called Schengen. That's their version of a common travel area where you drive between the two. And so if you Google what Theresa May has set out she wants to achieve, and you go back to the 29th of March, she wants to take back control of her borders. And so that's ill-defined as what that precisely means in relation to the common travel area, in relation to our options, in relation to potentially Schengen. And we have other legislation that we have a visa waiver recognition scheme with the UK, that if a Chinese visitor flies into to Dublin and goes to Trinity College, and then flies on to London, we co-recognize their visas. And so when you say unilaterally, as Theresa May is, I'm taking back control of my borders, that throws all of that up in the air. And at the very least, let's say your process, which now at the moment in Heathrow and the others is a way past, comes a 3-minute check or a 5-minute check, or US airports is 9 minutes a check, a massive queues in airports. So the whole thing about take back control of our borders, Schengen, visa waivers, and what that means for repression needs to be examined in more detail.
Are there any problems with the financial services industry in the context of common travel free
ownership? Well, yes. I think the answer is yes. I was going to say it depends on what the final sort of model is. Let's look at business setting up. Businesses currently in the UK setting up some sort of presence here. A lot of talk is that obviously there are going to be people here, but of course, that infrastructure that has existed for so many years in the UK and is huge, and businesses sunk millions and billions of pounds into that infrastructure, is still going to exist. So it's still going to be that very close link. But in a practical sense, that also means that there will be people going to and fro between Dublin and London in order to transact the financial services business that will be located here, whatever that is. And of course, the attractiveness of what we have at the moment, as far as facilitating that business is concerned, will be severely diminished if the common travel area is impacted, as Neil was suggesting, it might be a good thing.
It's worth noting that the common travel area has existed since the foundation of the Irish Free State back in the 1920s, but it's never been legislated before. It's not legally binding. Most people don't know that or appreciate that. It relies on cooperation and administrative arrangements between the Irish and the UK authorities. Yes, it's mentioned in a couple of protocols and treaties. Yes, it's been acknowledged in the joint statement, but we may have to see a situation where the consent of other EU member states is given to its continuation or its amendment. John, in the context of British-Irish trade, British-Irish relations, are you hearing common travel area as an issue, or is it something that we're just going to put aside and work on?
Well, so that touches, John, on the wider question of when are we going to have a conversation about the causes of what's happening? So if you want to pick the epicenter of the referendum debate, it was the piece about the UK calls immigration, and what the European Union calls freedom to travel, freedom to move. So it is quite scandalous on any level, but there hasn't been a conversation about free movement since the 23rd of June. And about the consequences of all of that for everybody. It's up, certainly for us, we're highly exposed to the consequences of Britain not coming to some arrangement on free movement. And Britain itself, the UK itself, whose economy may be about to tank, by the way, because we don't talk about what's going on inside the UK at the moment, but in the short term, the linkage of all the consequences of Brexit, the idea that Mrs. May would say on behalf of 60 million UK people, you know what, in order to stop people migrating into our land, we go off and have deals with the countries who buy and sell nothing with us today. It's just preposterous that that's become the narrative here. We have to go back to having a conversation and saying, on what basis will the EU and all of us come to terms with the ability, the importance of free movement, but the real world fact that it has to be managed in some way. And of course the EU has lots of precedents of managed free movement. Take Belgium for instance. All of us Irish citizens could move to Belgium tonight. We have the right to move as European citizens. But some people politely remind us in three months' time that we haven't got a job, that we might attempt to go home again. Like that's managed free movement. And there's been no conversation about this or many other variants of this to say how does the rest of Europe deal with this in practical terms? And until we begin to do that, we're running massive risks on the UK's exit to all of our existence here. I touched on the economy piece. We bought into the foreign exchange collapse piece, but the far more worrying thing now is declining UK economy. People talk about UK inflation at the consumer level 3%. Manufacturing input prices are rising at 17%. But that's hyperinflation, and that's been pent up and not passed on. Because 75% of the hedging place in Britain last June is still in place in January this year. It's now burning off. The consequences that within 3 to 6 months' time, and this
the baby pool of the conversation thus far, and these are the big warning signs coming out, right? And we have to get back to a conversation in order to build all of that.
John said at the beginning, just there, it's almost trade versus immigration, security versus free movement. Would you agree with that?
Well, I suppose one of the dominant things, and John Fitzgerald has did this for quite some time, is that our labour market is still pretty much connected to the British labour market quite significantly. And one of the, didn't feel like it, a 16% unemployment rate, but it would be much higher if the British economy wasn't doing well in terms of employment terms during that time. And, you know, professionally, the white collar, we see a lot of people making their living in London during the downturn, thankfully, that's reversing back now. So we are very connected. I myself, am troubled by speculating what would happen, in a very big if Brexit happened, what would happen next. I think it's actually happening faster than I anticipated. So I would have said the day after a Brexit accident, Britain would want single market access. I would never dream of trying to willfully close up into a different customs union, or ECJ. All of that's happening really quickly. It is forcing Irish business. Nobody's going up to the public airways on this. No business leader joins any public debate anymore because in the Twitter world, there's no rational court to be hearing on people. I just listen to the business news every morning about people spreading their bets into the UK economy, etc. It's dressed up as an investment play, but it's actually a preservation. So on the labour market, I would have thought that one of the problems we've had in the business community, kind of echoing John, on the 24th of June was we'd have to say, as Ireland, that shared labour market, that we too need to have controls over migration. I thought that would be the thing that would bring us into conflict with our EU 26 colleagues. As it happens, to John's point, the trade and investment things have actually come hurtling much faster, but underneath it's still an issue of migration because these two islands have disproportionately experienced that movement. And as business people, it's been great. It's been wonderful in terms of high productivity. But you know, people are only in the productive hours of the week. You've 21 8-hour seconds of the week. You know, five of those is 40-hour week going to the workplace. People live in the society 60 other units. And to the rest of the population, if the infrastructure isn't building fast enough, people will feel crowded out from the playground or from the school or from whatever. That's what led to the referendum. And then if fiscal rules are the thing that stops you from taking the resources you have and building that infrastructure fast enough, we're hurtling down for exactly the same kind of referendum decision here if we don't wake up. And if we don't appeal to that force majeure issue that I've talked about and get this one size does not fit all, then I think we're in a conflict with other EU 26. And I don't take a huge amount of soccer, I must admit, from the success of being pre-announced in the negotiation. I think it's great diplomatically. But you could also take the reverse view is that we're actually in war in court. One is trying to take us with them by saying you have a backdoor option here. The others are saying, well, that's fine. What about Spain and Gibraltar? What about Cyprus? Yes, we'll give you our.
I'm not sure what you're actually saying. Fundamentally, what you're saying.
I'm saying we've got a big, our big problem is not with Britain. Our big problem is with the other EU-26.
Would you agree with that?
We're apolitical, naturally apolitical. We just want to keep travel from tourism moving outside of the
continent. PwC is known for its political views.
Well, kind of somebody with political affiliations as the managing partner, but I would actually agree with Danny in that respect, to be honest, because, you know, if it was left to us, we'd be doing all sorts of deals with the UK because it's our most natural trading partner and always has been, but we are going to be constrained from doing what we want with the UK by the EU, and we've got a call to make about which club we really want to be in. We're saying it is the EU 27, but if we're saying that, we've got to take the consequences of it, which means that we won't do the deals that we'd like to do with the UK.
a very interesting job.
You're a tiny little island like us, punching famously above our weight like us, you have to think good about quite a few things. So we have to manage three distinct great relationships, the EU, the UK, and the US. And we don't do too badly at that, actually. We somehow manage to be fostered, if not more than accord, by the law. And the serious point is, I think we're very well served by our officials and diplomats and our embassies. And we surely need that. We're not going to go down an IR exit road in this discussion given today, but anybody in the room, no matter our persuasions, would caution against having a referendum about it anytime soon, given what referendum. But we do need to have a conversation that we're entitled to have about where is the European Union taking us and our membership up. So for instance, like in the Cameron settlement, the four pillars, the shortest chapter in that, and of course nobody read it anyway, least of all British media, but the shortest chapter in that 17-page document was one page, section 4 on competitiveness. It was 2/3 of the page of A4. That's all it got. But the EU pledged itself to fostering greater competitiveness, not least for its SMEs and cutting red tape, etc., etc. And that was no sooner not read than it was taken off the table again. It's a dead letter now. It has no effect.
Could have been there, John. I was given a presentation recently where we were talking about Brexit, and I had to step back kind of at the start and say, what is Britain actually divorcing? And that's an important point, that you get immersed in the process of divorce. And there's a famous Monty Python film, people know it, where what did the Romans ever do for us? And if you have to go back to brass tacks, what has the EU done for Ireland? And you have to go back to pre-73 to see that. Our road infrastructure was a mess. Our farming was impoverished, our education system was quite poor, our standards of safety, our standards of security, all of those have been brought on by the EU project. And one thing the EU has been particularly bad at doing is telling people what it has been doing. It is lousy PR, it's very good at other stuff, and that we, as today, good members of the EU, haven't sat back and enjoyed and savored the road network, all of it, the free travel we talked about earlier, and that could get lost in a very narrow conversation.
I think that's interesting. Declan Gallagher, Barry referred to earlier on, speaking across the Labour this morning, said that when Mrs. May, indeed before that, when David Cameron spoke with her with the Chinese, when the reports back in Britain were of what the Chinese said in response, they omitted to say that China said we're very happy. Because we want to invest in the European Union. That bit never got translated back into Asia. But I do slightly fear personally, probably as a firm, because we're the only Irish law firm that has an office in Brussels, and we've been there since 1973, 74, and we value that very much both for ourselves as a law firm, but also for what it brings to Irish clients. I must say, I'm extremely concerned if Irish industry led us along what I call the David McWilliams path. Let's bang the EU26 and get as good a deal as we possibly can out. I'm reminded of another Monty Python movie where the guy gets his legs cut off. Don't cut his lost leg off the leg off the leg. If we ended up outside the European Union and became once again effectively a satellite of the UK, that would surely be disastrous.
But I don't think anybody is seriously talking about it at all. I think we have to feel completely secure in our ability to have a conversation that appreciates absolutely what EU membership has uniquely given us. It's no question. And yet be able to say, as fully paid up members, committed to the future, and the ideas as well as the operational effects, to say we need to be part of the conversation about how the EU is as strong as it needs to be and delivers in this context a competitive platform for business to prosper globally, but also to take care of Ireland's utter connectivity to the UK. And we don't have, it shouldn't be that we have to make a choice.
That nice quiet conversation has exploded. Any questions or comments on the floor? John.
I'm rather surprised at this call for stage 8 from the panel. Stage 8 means that you have to raise taxes to give money to certain companies. Ireland, when that was legal in the past, Ireland would always allude single market is outlawed at state aid. And if you look at the recent issue of the Oxford Review of Economic Policy, it's a paper on what the UK could do in this regard. And the answer is the UK would be mad to increase taxes in the United Kingdom to pay state aid. So I really don't think that we're looking for any exemptions. This is something that we want the same rules applied with respect to the United Kingdom for everybody in the EU, and that will benefit us.
I think that's fine, John, if you're not in an angry food business that's actually struggling with this today and has to make the corporate decisions, given that they are hampered by state aid rules, when the Reserve being another big competitor that's already actively flaunting that on the way out of the EU. I think it's a nice idea, theoretically, but there is a force majority going on for real businesses that are actually trying to compete right now with exchange rate movements. Those rules are binding.
I think I agree with Danny on that point. I think, well, again, it's a tribute to the Irish diplomacy and the Irish finance especially. They've laid hikers they expect over a period of time, like this phrase, serious disturbance to the Irish economy, particularly in the context of that business. And I think whilst there's not going to be a block exemption, there may well be some sort of guidelines sought, which wouldn't be unique to Ireland, but which we might qualify more than others might do, should I say. The other possibility is the Stability and Growth Pact, but that only allows exceptional spending in certain, and today's it's only for refugee situations, etc.
John, just on that, so in respect to Joe's point of returning that was earlier on, for me, the issue isn't about the matter of state aid, it's what's done with it. And I mean, there's undoubtedly a shock to the system, to say the very least. If you go back to the Whittaker piece, I mean, we have a hell of a lot to do to position this country, this society, this economy to be successful over the next number of decades. And for instance, I just instance one other, the food and agribusiness sector is uniquely exposed, but there's a generic one across education and really getting to a world-class third-level education system that can help us to compete not just today but in the future as well. Now, at the simplest level, I was with an EI client yesterday, a very successful and a very appreciative EI client, who said that they were the only one in their sector who translates their work in Germany into German so that they can sell in German. At the most basic level, we're still not teaching businesses and citizens the skills of European languages, for the sake, 40 years on. And we're definitely not addressing the running sore of third level education. It sells reports. We don't need any more reports. We need to get political bravery to make decisions to take us to the next level. And the shock to the economy needs some of those big macro factors to be addressed now. And if that leads into a state aid or as Danny characterized it, spending some of our own money within the rules, then I'm for that.
Two gentlemen,
ladies and
gentlemen.
We're in the Euro area. Sorry. We're in the Euro area, which...
Can I ask you just to identify yourself?
Sorry. David Cron, I'm a member of the European Economic Social Committee and also the Institute. We are in the Euro area, which makes our position somewhat less flexible than that of the UK, in that we are going to be and are governed by certain rules and certain limitations to how we can respond to trade difficulties. And it's likely that the EU are going to pursue as a priority the preservation of the euro area above even the EU area. And how do we play this game where the push is more likely to be towards a fiscal union or in that direction, where we are still wanting to ensure that we preserve this east-west trade to the UK. How do we balance that pressure?
Well, I mean, in terms of fiscal union, I suppose the practical output of that is the likes of the common consolidated tax base. I think we probably fairly unanimously have railed against that. I won't speak for everybody necessarily, but most people railed against it because we have seen the benefit to Ireland of setting our own fiscal policy to the extent that we can. And of course,
what we have has been approved by the EU. That's a policy that we've always done. I mean, since Ireland became an outward-facing economy back in the sort of mid to late 1950s, with export sales relief and all of that sort of stuff. So I just think that it would be wrong for Ireland to accede to the common consolidated tax base, no matter what, because once we do that, we are swallowed up within this landmass, which we're not even physically a part of, where the capital intensity on that landmass is far greater than we see here in Ireland. And as I think Danny said very early on, here we are, a little island off a G7 country, and we just get lost. So I think we just have to stand our ground on this, and if it requires unanimity to get to that common consolidated tax base, we can't give it. I'm personally very clear on that, and anybody I've spoken to in business would be very clear on that.
And if it goes ahead with enhanced cooperation?
Well, I think that's a mess. I really think that is just a complete mess.
Thank you, Andrew Doyle, former member of the European Parliament, member of the Institute. If I could pick up that last point first, one of the points I had here to ask was what exactly you were saying, Danny, about the common consolidated corporation tax base. I didn't quite understand what you meant, and I don't think it was what the last speaker has just said, but I'd be interested in your view on that. There has to be border posts on the perimeter of the EU of some description and somewhere. Any commentary here on whether it is a runner or whether it would be viable to have the EU-UK border at the ports on an all-island basis in Ireland? Is that a realistic runner? I would be interested in views, you know, the considered views of the experts here on that. We haven't mentioned it. And I was actually listening to Tony Blair down in the Wicklow Hills a week or two ago. And even though he wouldn't be my political persuasion, and we don't have views about his backstory in certain areas, certainly on the EU Brexit issue, he is fascinating, even now. And as far as he's concerned, it's not all over yet. I found that hard to understand initially, but when we've listened to him for 45 or 50 minutes developing it all, he basically hopes for a massive majority for Theresa May. He didn't say it this way, but effectively he was saying it would bury Jeremy Corbyn in the Labour Party. Now, he did not say that, as Daniel just put that, but that would be the effect. And that there will be such a political reaction, which is bubbling there, just beneath the surface, that you would have another opposition party, quote unquote, I say that advisedly, rise from the ashes somewhere, because a massive majority for Theresa May might bury UKIP and bury Labour. And what's the political scenario in the UK after that? In other words, could you have an action reaction, and could it actually get a proper debate going on what the electorate in Britain actually voted for? I just would be interested in your points, your views on that. The final point is, nobody mentioned the Great Repeal Bill here today. I was hoping somebody would raise that, because I can't quite make up my mind whether it is a pragmatic solution and is practical, or it is a recipe for chaos. Apart from accepting that it was a fop to the British electorate, you know, 44 years member of the EEC and the EU, and 24,000 bits of legislation later. And it's all going to be roped into the Great Repeal Bill, which for the next 30 or 40 or 50 years will be cherry-picked. Some dumped, some amended, and some accepted. I mean, what's that all about, and what does it mean for us? Thank you.
Danny, you take the border question first? Well, I was going to take the corporation tax, if that's okay. Avril, on my point, this goes on the corporation, common consolidated corporation tax base issue, is that shareholders of corporations don't want to give away the money, but the state wants to get the money of corporations from the citizens, so that's the game. So it's all about the money. And so the CCCT sovereignty over your corporate tax rate,
yeah.
but to actually grab and redistribute the money, which is embedded in the Apple tax case, actually, the formula apportionment. In that regard, looking at the formulas that we've done the work on, there's at least 50% of the Irish corporate tax revenue in play at the moment. So circa this year around 8 billion in corporate tax revenue, that will be a 4 billion handoff in the future. If the Irish citizens actually go through the scenario of that and find where that has to be collected in other taxes, attitudes will change towards the CCCTB. I have nothing against the CCCTB as a point of principle. For businesses, if it worked, if it was a choice, it makes sense for businesses to actually have a common system of corporation tax. A lot of sense to that. But as a citizen of Ireland, this is a big factor that would be very brave for us to run into. The other point was, if you've got sovereignty over the corporate tax rate, I believe, I'm actually certain that Britain is going to go down into the same zone as Ireland on the corporation tax rate, and it will happen very quickly. And I would like, for people to know more than I, the following scenario is that when Britain's out of the EU, you don't have to have a single corporation tax rate. That's an EU requirement. It may cause hue and cry between the retailers of Britain versus whoever they want to favour with a different lower rate. But a society that's sovereign can actually cherry pick and get right into the heart. And if you want to have evidence, Britain already did it in the last decade. It was called the patent income box. It was deliberately designed towards the med tech and biopharma, and we reacted in that regard. And so,
just
that's what I said.
On the border.
Yeah, so I said at the top that anything can happen, and ideas that seemed fanciful barely a few months ago suddenly gained a bit of traction along the way, and where the border might be is definitely a red box of tricks. And I refer to having knowledge from running airports, but I'm always tickled by the idea that when I fly to London, as I do every week, I can walk off the concourse at Heathrow, get onto the tube, I can be down in Oxford Street in an hour, nobody's asking for any identification whatsoever. When I fly home the following night, I have to show my passport at the airport. And when I take the car ferry, as I do from time to time, I have to change my documents. So we get a little bit kind of woolly in that space. The real issue is where trade impositions and embeddings might be imposed, and of course there's a ball of political stuff around that. I think the new dimension in recent weeks, Alan, is the acknowledgement that there's something about Ireland, and it's called Northern Ireland, and therefore where the border actually is around Northern Ireland becomes extremely important. When Ulster farmers wake up and find that their economy is going down the plunge, they may change their view of where they think the border should be.
Just very quickly, Admiral, in terms of the border, you know better than me, right through the 40 years of troubles, when it was a political and security impetus to control that border entirely, and roads were closed, these army checkpoints, the British were unable to control the border. It was so porous. So we're fooling ourselves if we believe that border can be controlled now with a motorway that just drives straight. There is precedent for what you're talking about. You're probably aware in the Second World War, when it was absolute impetus to control the border, the border control points between Northern Ireland were on the sea, on the coast. And so there's a political challenge in that for everything that's happening in Brexit.
I'd say if you wanted to wake the people, because it's a British requirement, if they didn't have a way to wake the people or millions, it would be a catastrophe. So they reintroduce all the same legislation that they have in the European Union on day one. And as you say, over periods of time, they will amend and change something. That's called arbitration. One gentleman has had very some time. It's a short question, I know. Perhaps you can ask a
Sorry, thank you. Thank you for remembering me. My name is Larry Walsh, and I'm a member of the Institute. I am not only depressed, but I'm completely annoyed at the contrasting tone between this session and the earlier session. And I remember back to the good old days when we entered the EEC.
Sorry, is this a question or a speech?
I've been short already, thanks for the introduction. I remember back to when we joined the EEC, we were told it would be a marvellous opportunity to diversify away from the British market. Now that obviously has not happened, and we are seeing all these rabbits staring into headlights now. So what has happened that remarkable opportunity back in the early 70s when we were supposed to be diversifying away from the British market.
Okay.
We obviously haven't done that.
Well,
why not?
Thank you very much for that question. I suspect that most of us would disagree with that analysis, but we leave it at that as we may. Can I, on all of your behalf, thank Jim McDonald, Neil McCarthy, John O'Reilly,